Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Slavery's Exiles, the story of the American Maroons, by Sylviane A. Diouf. Narrated by Chanté McCormick. Introduction.
Lord, Lord, yes indeed, plenty of slaves used to run away. Why, them woods was full of them, child,
recalled Arthur Green of Virginia. He knew that some stayed there for a few days only, but he also knew that his friend Patton and his family had lived in the woods for 15 years, until Lee's surrender. Like them, over more than two centuries, men, women, and children made the southern wilderness their home. They hid in the mountains of Virginia and the low swamps of South Carolina. They stayed in the neighborhood or paddled their way to secluded places. They buried themselves underground or erected snug little habitations. They were Africans 2 days off the slave ship and people who intimately knew the geographic and social environment, its constraints, and the way to navigate it. They were not truants who had absconded for a short while to rest, avoid a beating, or recover from one, take a break, or visit relatives and friends on neighboring plantations. They were not runaways making their way through the wilds to reach a southern city or a free state or to cross international borders to find freedom under a foreign power. The people whose stories are the subject of this book went to the southern woods to stay. Although it is based on scores of cases, Slavery's Exiles neither attempts to relate all documented instances of maroonage, nor is it about all maroons. The individuals and groups studied here shared three key characteristics. They settled in the wilderness, lived there in secret, and were not under any form of direct control by outsiders. These criteria, which seem to encompass all maroons, do not. The well-known maroons of Spanish Florida, for example, are absent from this book because they were officially recognized as free, even if in a limited way, by Spain, who offered sanctuary to runaways from the British colonies and later the United States. People who settled among American Indians in their territories are not covered either for the same reason. They lived in villages and towns and not the wilderness, where their hosts openly accepted them and controlled them to various degrees. This book also excludes individuals and communities that some scholars define as maroons, based on a broad definition of maroonage, as the act of fleeing enslavement. In this vein, historian Steve Hahn notes that black enclaves in the North, which attracted new runaways and gave rise to autonomous leadership, social structures, institutions, and cultural practices, are historically specific variants of the broad phenomenon of maroons. But by lumping together divergent experiences, we run the risk of flattening each group's specificities and of obscuring the maroon experience, as defined here, in favor of better-known forms of resistance. Moreover, this approach hides key differences between maroons and runaways who lived in black enclaves. The latter refused enslavement, but not the larger society, which they wanted to be a part of, even if they knew it could only be at its periphery. Although they organized to challenge them, runaways and free blacks continued to live under the discriminatory laws of white society, still subservient and controlled. The experience of the people hidden in the wilds, the maroons examined in this book, could not have been more different. Autonomy was at the heart of their project, and exile the means to realize it. The need for foolproof concealment, the exploitation of their natural environment and their stealth raids on farms and plantations were at the very core of their lives. Secrecy and the particular ecology of their refuges forced them to devise specific ways to occupy the land and to hide within it. Negotiating and manipulating their landscape dictated the types of dwellings they could erect, when they could walk outside or light a fire. They determined if, where, and how much land they could cultivate, what kind of animals they could keep, how they got weapons and clothes, and what types of interaction they could have with the world they had left behind. An understudied phenomenon. While numerous books have been devoted to the Maroons of South and Central America and the Caribbean, none focus on the 13 colonies and the United States. The first historian to seriously tackle the issue was Herbert Aptheker, who published the classic article, Maroons Within the Present Limits of the United States, in 1939, and Additional Data on American Maroons, which relates to one case in 1947. Aptheker's research was groundbreaking because it established the existence of Maroons, but it did not describe or analyze their experience. At the other end of the spectrum, some post-Aptheker historians have denied the reality of Maroonage in the United States. For Michael Mullen, the absence of a Maroon dimension in the South, a serious loss for Southern slaves, is symbolized by the emphasis in the studies of resistance on such individuals as Harriet Tubman. Writing about the Southern Maroons, with the exception of those in Florida whom he recognized as genuine, Eugene Genovese affirmed, they typically huddled in small units and may be called Maroons only as a courtesy. Many, he claimed, degenerated into wild desperados who preyed on anyone, black, white, or red, in their path. Southerners who reserved the terminology Maroons for the people of Jamaica and Suriname were precursors in the denial of the American Maroons' existence. They called the people in their midst outliers, or simply and much more often, runaways and banditti. And in the same spirit, never called Maroon settlements by their names or gave them any, thus negating their very existence. In the 1990s, Gilbert C. Dinn and Gwendolyn Midlow Hall each devoted one chapter in works on larger issues to the community led by St. Malo in 1780s Louisiana, and John Hope Franklin and Lauren Schwenninger covered the Maroon dimension in Runaway Slaves, Rebels on the Plantation, in a short section called Collective Resistance. More recently, Timothy Lockley has compiled a well-researched source book and newspaper articles on the Maroons of South Carolina, and American Maroons have also appeared in Swamp, Environmental, and Literary Studies that focus on the interaction of wilderness dwellers and nature, and connections between the representation of swamps and Maroons in literature. Alvin O. Thompson's Flight to Freedom, African Runaways and Maroons in the Americas, is a review, synthesis, and analysis of recent works on the main Maroon states and colonies, which explains why it centers on Brazil, Jamaica, and Suriname, and why the United States appear only very briefly. The absence of large colonies and the lack of Maroon wars, both thought of as characteristics of Maroonage, may explain why American Maroons have for the most part remained under the radar. It is telling that only those of Florida who lived in large communities and fought in the Seminole Wars have generated attention and come to mind whenever one mentions Maroons in the United States. The overall invisibility of the American Maroons thus seems to be due to restrictive definitions of Maroonage that do not correspond to the reality, whether in North America or in the rest of the hemisphere. Beyond Petit and Grand. For the past few decades, when and wherever Maroonage has been studied, it has generally fallen into two neat categories, petit and grand. Gabriel Dubien created and popularized these concepts in his 1966 article, Le Maroonage aux Antilles Françaises au XVIIIe siècle. Planters distinguished two types of Maroonage. He asserted, grand Maroonage was, in the true sense, flight from the plantation with no intention of ever returning. while absences of a few days were called petit maronage. Debian's categories have been tweaked over the years. To grand maronage have been appended notions of guerrilla activity, high numbers, and long distance, and the terminology has become synonymous with large, long-lived, warring communities in the Caribbean and South America, despite the fact that, as anthropologist and historian Richard Price has remarked, known variously as palenques, quilombos, mocambos, cumbes, laderas, or mambises, these new societies range from tiny bands that survived less than a year to powerful states encompassing thousands of members and surviving for generations or even centuries. Alvin Thompson notes that since most slaves escaped individually and collective flight was rare, it is perhaps more useful to speak of individual and collective maroonage in order to recognize the lonely deserters. The study of maroonage in the United States has led me to reconsider the various definitions and classifications used so far and to develop a more expansive vision to better reflect what happened on the ground. It is clear that neither numbers, distance, longevity, nor guerrilla-type activities are the most significant factors that define maroonage. Yet these criteria are often applied collectively or singularly as researchers see fit. Such practices prevent one from noticing, let alone understanding, the experiences of a large number of maroons, those who lived, individually and collectively, not far away, but on the periphery of farms, plantations, and cities. Contemporary documents refer to these people as runaways or outliers, but neither term takes their specificity into account. Some of the men and women who lived behind the plantations were not technically runaways because they settled right where they were or went back to their home place still on owner's or former owner's property. Their particular experience needs to be described by a new terminology. I call them borderland maroons. As is manifest here, borderlands is taken in its most basic sense. It means the wild land that bordered the farms and plantations and the cities and towns. The other terminology used in this book is hinterland maroons, which refers mostly to communities, whatever their size, that settled in areas further away from the borderlands. Their main characteristic was that they were secluded and hard to reach, not primarily because of distance, but because of the difficulty of the terrain. Thus, within the larger definition of the maroons who are the focus of this study, using wilderness, secrecy, and self-determination as parameters, geography helps bring to light the whole range of maroon life that evolved in what I call the maroon landscape. Maroons are commonly imagined as occupying small perimeters deeply hidden in swamps and woods, and as detached from the surrounding slave territory as possible. But maroonage is better apprehended, explained, and understood as being anchored in and making use of interconnected areas within the larger landscape. Only when viewed from that geographical perspective can its true scope and importance be uncovered. When applied to the study of slavery, geography has been an enlightening device that has revealed the existence of a slavery landscape, slave landscape, plantations landscape, and swamp landscape. The various studies geography has inspired have offered new ways of understanding the world of the men and women whose lives were constrained by it, and whose work transformed it. They have also brought to light the manner in which they appropriated the land, creating in it their own spaces of culture and resistance. But absent from this geography, although it was well-trodden and of singular importance in resistance, is the maroon landscape that simultaneously touched on others, overlapped with some, and was to some degree separated from all the others. Studies have shown that while there were variations due to different owners' wealth, as well as the terrain and type of crops grown, the general landscape of the plantations was made up of three main sections. The most tightly controlled consisted of the so-called big house, built on high and dry ground, close to the river landing or the main road. Adjacent were its dependencies, the kitchen, dairy, carriage house, stable, smokehouse, laundry, and the domestics' quarters. It was a world of stringent social and racial boundaries, under lock and key, where everything and everybody had to be in their assigned place, below and behind, as an overt symbol of their supposed inferiority and expected submission, lay the sphere of the enslaved, the quarters, the cabins, the family gardens, hog pens, and chicken coops, when allowed, and on larger estates, the mess hall and the hospital. Cabins were usually placed in neat rows along a street. They were occasionally scattered in clusters in the fields on very large estates, an imposed arrangement that reflected a European sense of control and order. Their close proximity, one to the other, was not conducive to concealment, not even to privacy. Rundown and cramped, the quarters were the centers of African and African-American life, the places where culture was maintained and created, where knowledge, hope, love, and despair were shared. They were, of course, completely open to overseers, planters, patrollers, and militia who could, and by law had to, search them at will. Beyond was the work ground, the blacksmith and carpenter shops, the mule barn, the cow house, the fields, and the pastures. On large holdings, quarters and work areas could be located far from the main house. A 1742 map of John Carter's Shirley Plantation in Virginia shows that the distance between these two sections was about a mile. On the sugar estate, Laura, in Louisiana, the last of 69 cabins stood 4 miles from the mansion. As anthropologist John M. Vlatch has observed, enslaved men and women were under control, but they were not totally coerced by that control because while they were being held down, they were also being held out and away from the center of authority. Behind the big house, the cabins and the fields were woods, bayous, marshes, swamps, moccasins, palustrine wetlands, and creeks, some of which belonged to the farms and plantations, land still undeveloped that provided game, firewood, and timber that could be cleared, dried, and exploited. To planters and overseers, these marginal lands were untamed, out of control, savage, dark, and mysterious, just like the Negroes and other slaves, whom the preamble of the 1712 South Carolina Slave Code described as having barbarous, wild, savage natures. It is, for example, in one of these areas that a group of men dubbed Daring Banditti had established their skulking quarters. Two had been seen in the summer of 1808 and hotly pursued, but they had made their escape into a thick and almost impenetrable underwood. It may seem that they lived deep in the forest, but their camp was located between Rich Will's mansion house and Mr. Strider's mill near Leetown, West Virginia. To the men and women in the quarters, the borderlands were concurrently wild and social. At night and on Sundays, or whenever they had finished their daily assignments, men could exert their talents as hunters of raccoons, opossums, squirrels, birds, ducks, alligators, and rabbits. With their traps, snares, fire, wooden boxes, blowguns, and occasionally dogs, some became providers for their families of perhaps as much as half the meat they consumed. From the shore, or the dugout canoes they made with the tree trunks they felled in the backwoods, families gathered oysters, turtles, terrapins, and crabs, and fished with poles, nets, weirs, and traps. Depending on farmers' and planters' acquiescence, they kept pigs, sheep, and occasionally cattle there, and they could also have their own gardens. In Georgia, Charles Ball worked in a plot a mile and a half away from the quarters. In the borderlands, men and women gathered the herbs, barks, and roots that formed the basis of their medicinal remedies. They collected black moss to fill mattresses and seagrass and bark to make baskets for their own use and for sale. Some ventured quite far, like Ball, who had become well acquainted with the woods and swamps for several miles round his plantation. The secret paths men used to circulate without a pass as they illicitly visited potential mates or their wives and children crisscrossed the borderlands up or down to neighbors' plantations. Natural clearings were gathering places to pray and listen to liberating sermons or barbecue hogs and cows. Borderlands were spaces of freedom that provided what enslaved people were denied elsewhere: autonomy, mobility, enterprise, a sense of physical security, freedom from scrutiny, control over their time and movement, and access to varied foods. As historian S. Max Edelson stresses, planters tried to impose a hard line of separation between plantations and wilderness, but slaves opened and inhabited the spaces in between. It was behind the farms and plantations that people recuperated after a beating or escaped the most debilitating cadences of the crop cycles. But it was also where others settled, determined to stay. The Maroons inhabited the fluid landscape of the borderlands that shifted with the tides and was remodeled by the floods and the droughts and the clearing and the drying of lands for cultivation. The men and women who made it their home can be called Borderland Maroons. They stood at the intersection of three worlds. One was their refuge, another the white-controlled territory of the fields, the big house outbuildings, and sometimes the big house itself. The third was the physical and social terrain carved out by the enslaved community, from the quarters to the neighboring plantations and farms. To be successful, Maroons needed to build and maintain a symbiotic relation with these three geographical and social nodes. Hidden during the day, they cautiously appropriated the plantation grounds at night, walking from the borderlands to the quarters and up to the dairy, the smokehouse, and the kitchen, on whose supplies they largely depended for survival. They intimately knew, and night after night, year after year, traversed the entire map that they transformed into a space of interdependence, networks, and exchange. With time, cities, farms, and plantations superimposed their ever-increasing geography of cleared grounds and fields upon part of the southern land. As South Carolina Lieutenant Governor William Bull remarked in 1770, many large swamps that offered inaccessible shelter for deserting slaves and wild beasts had been drained and planted with rice. Yet, this man-made environment was still surrounded by dense forests and/or wetlands, and the sight of vast swaths of wild land was often surprising to northerners. One traveler describing the region in the 1850s wrote, "It abounds with interminable swamps, impenetrable canebrakes, and inaccessible everglades, the safe and secure hiding place for Indians, runaway slaves. There is a most luxurious growth of canes, shrubs, vines, creepers, briars, forming a dense brake or jungle." Lewis W. Payne, a white man who spent 6 years in jail for trying to help a Maroon escape from Georgia, noted that Maroons often stayed in the woods for years, thanks to the natural cover offered by the thick vegetation. "There are large tracts of land," he wrote, "covered with heavy timber, containing not only deep and almost impenetrable swamps, but caves, holes, shelving rocks, and banks. In these, they secrete themselves during the daytime, venturing abroad only by night. Past the borderlands, further away from the seat of white power, maroon communities, sometimes of several dozen individuals, settled in the secluded zones of the hinterland. They chose spaces whose topography offered good cover, vantage points for sentries, closeness to a source of clean water, and adequate soil to grow crops. Not only did these places have to be hard to reach, but they also had to provide easy access to the plantations and towns where some items continued to be traded or stolen. Therefore, seclusion, not distance, was in most cases the determining factor in the establishment of a settlement in the hinterland. Borderlands and hinterlands formed the maroon landscape, a vast area whose several parts were connected by secret paths, discreet trails, and waterways navigated under cover of night, and whose outer, intangible limits reached dangerously into the plantations and cities. Situated miles apart, borderlands and hinterlands were not exclusive. Some maroons settled in the borderlands and did not venture elsewhere, but others migrated to the hinterland and then returned to the borderlands. Hinterland maroons sometimes moved to the borderlands before going back to their secluded settlements. These maroon migrations were complex, especially for large groups. At the point of departure, the migrants had to collect enough food for the journey and the days ahead. They had to establish a safe itinerary that would take them through the woods and sometimes across rivers and creeks. Their travel had to be done at night, and they had to find secure spots where a dozen or more people could safely rest during the day. At the point of destination, they needed to locate a space with adequate hunting and gathering prospects and easy access to farms and plantations. And they had to build a new network of complicity. Each relocation, whether at the borderlands or in the hinterland, was a jump into the unknown. Some maroon groups succeeded in establishing camps in several counties, not a small achievement. The maroon landscape as a whole encompassed the slave's landscape, what historian Rhys Isaac has termed their alternative territorial system, comprised of personal gardens, paths, trails, meeting spots, granaries, and storehouses clandestinely visited. Maroons used these trails, searched the same outbuildings for food and supplies, and went up in the quarters to get their share of their relatives' vegetables. But whereas their landscape covered the whole map of slave territory, official and secret, parts of the maroons' own land, especially the hinterland, remained unknown to most people on the plantations. Africans added another dimension to this secret landscape. As some attempted to return to their homelands, they embarked on clandestine journeys through the wilds in order to get to the ultimate place of autonomy outside white control and power. The most remote border of the maroon landscape was Africa. The maroons' landscape was a place of exile whose settlers sought not only freedom, but also self-determination. It was a dynamic site of empowerment, migrations, encounters, communication, exchange, solidarity, resistance, and entangled stories. It was also, of course, a contested terrain that slaveholders, overseers, drivers, slave hunters, dogs, militias and patrollers strove to control and frequently invaded. Still, it was a place of movement, independence, and reinvention where new types of lives were created and evolved, where networks were built and solidified, and where solidarity expressed itself in concrete ways that rendered the maroons' alternative way of life possible. Methodology and sources. This social history of the maroons has a wide span. It focuses on Virginia, the Carolinas, Georgia, and Louisiana, with occasional forays into other colonies and states. This regional approach can vividly retrace the Maroons' experience because it conforms to the reality on the ground. Maroons moved around the South. The Maroon landscape was not contained by county, colony, state, and international lines and borders. On the contrary, Maroons used them to their advantage, crossing and recrossing them as needed. This very appropriation of various spaces was an intrinsic part of their experience. Slavery's exiles also has a long temporal scope, the entire slavery period, and is organized thematically rather than chronologically because its focus is on the Maroons' individual and communal experience. Their world is at the center and the rest of Southern society, black and white, at its periphery. Viewed from that perspective, outside events were not overwhelmingly significant because the inescapable reality that superseded everything else and made many external factors almost inconsequential was that the Maroons' experience rested on their remaining invisible no matter what the circumstances were. This was true in the 1600s, continued to be true during the Revolutionary War, and remained so in 1862. It was the case in Georgia as it was in Virginia. The 18th century laws that governed runaways and Maroons were essentially current in the 1800s. The punishments the Maroons risked were also consistent. Although extreme sentences like dismemberment were no longer practiced by the 19th century, most common, severe whippings, sale, outlawry, and death if not compliant when captured, hung over the heads of all Maroons, whether they lived in 1772 Virginia or 1856 North Carolina. Variations in time and space are noted if relevant, but as will become clear, the diversity of circumstances did not supersede the basic consistency of the larger experience. While secrecy surrounded their lives, the experiences of the Maroons are far from being unknowable, even if they have not been as well documented in firsthand accounts as those of the runaways who settled in the North and Canada and gave oral and written accounts of their adventures to promote abolitionism. For the Maroons, the alternative to bondage was a clandestine life outside white-controlled space, and abolitionists had no use for them except to paint them as lost souls living among and like wild beasts, so as to underscore the cruelty of slavery. Still, Maroons could have shared their stories after emancipation, but as was true for the majority of runaways, those who remained in the South, they lacked the high drama of the escape to the North. There was little sensationalism to be found in the Maroons' daily lives, and their narrative of autonomous survival without benevolent white involvement would likely have had little mass appeal. To complicate matters, nothing in the United States approaches the kind of resources on Maroons available for some countries. There were no Captain Stedman or Moravian missionaries to the Southern Maroons as in Suriname. There are no 28 slave hunters' diaries to be explored as in Cuba. No maps of settlements are to be found as they have been for some communities in Brazil, Suriname, Hispaniola, or Cuba. Moreover, descendants of Maroons still live in some of the communities their ancestors founded in Brazil, Jamaica, Colombia, Suriname, or French Guiana, for instance, where oral history, memories, myths, religious practices, languages, crafts, material culture, and farming techniques have been passed on over several centuries and are still alive today. No such rich reservoir of information exists in the South, where most settlements disappeared within a few years or even less. That being said, a variety of primary sources inform this study. For the 17th century, most of them consist of legal documents, such as acts passed by the legislatures and court minutes. Although they do not address the Maroon experience, they provide in filigree valuable evidence about the profile of the Maroons, where they established themselves, and what activities they engaged in. For the 18th and 19th centuries, white society's perspective can be found in petitions, letters, county books, parish records, official correspondence, travelers' accounts, and plantation records. An abundance of runaway slave advertisements and jail notices map Maroon geography, detail individual stories, and go to the heart of some of the very reasons for their existence. Newspapers also related their activities, the killings of white men who tracked them down, the destruction of settlements, and the capture of individuals and groups. Fortunately, a number of other sources help reconstruct the Maroon stories in their own voices and the voices of their relatives and friends. Trial records are an important source of first-person accounts. To be sure, any such document must be handled with caution, as defendants and prosecutors can distort, lie, and minimize or overstate facts and claims. The threat of and actual use of torture, sometimes bluntly acknowledged, must add a layer of circumspection to the person's account. But valuable information can be gathered by comparing testimonies and paying attention to details that were not central to the trials, that people planted rice, fished, or pounded China smilax, a bushy plant with small fruit, did not matter to the prosecution, but these bits of evidence illuminate the Maroons' daily life. Memoirs and autobiographies of former runaways and freed people are a surprisingly rich source of information. Some lived in the woods and swamps for extended periods of time and, when unable to continue, decided to migrate north, while others marooned as they waited for an opportunity to leave the south. They and others had relatives or friends who settled in the wilds and relayed what they knew of their particular experience. Additionally, in the 1930s, the Works Progress Administration, WPA, interviewed over 2,000 formerly enslaved men and women, and these records reveal a wealth of details about numerous aspects of the Maroons' lives, how their community perceived them, and how kin and friends supported them. Numerous interviews offer unique insights into their experience, from building a shelter to getting food, and provide invaluable information about the support they enjoyed on the plantations, what they looked like when they emerged from the woods, how they were treated when captured, and other details. Who the Maroons were. What led them to choose this way of life over alternatives, what forms of maroonage they created and how they differed from one another, what their individual and collective lives were like, how they organized themselves to survive, and how their particular story fits into the larger narrative of slave resistance are questions that this study seeks to answer. To uncover, recreate, and analyze the world of slavery's exiles, this book is built around one chronological and subsequent thematic chapters. Chapter 1 looks chronologically and geographically at maroonage in Southern history, its development, the legal measures taken to try to prevent it, and the efforts launched to capture or kill individuals and destroy their communities. Studies throughout the Americas show that Africans ran away disproportionately and were also represented in Maroon communities in excess of their percentage in the larger population. Chapter 2 examines the characteristics of African maroonage and the specific experience of newly arrived Africans. The chapters that follow focus on the experience of American-born Maroons. Chapter 3 explores the reason why some people chose to settle in the borderlands and how they related to the slave world that stretched beyond their doorsteps. A detailed description and analysis of the various aspects of their lives is the subject of Chapter 4. Past the borderlands, hinterland maroon communities were born, lived, and disappeared. Chapter 5 indicates the ways they formed and tried to ensure their survival through diversified economic and protective strategies. Chapter 6 delves into the complexity and fluidity of the maroon experience. It follows an 18th century Louisiana community that straddled the whole breadth of the maroon landscape as it migrated and lived alternatively on the borderlands and in the hinterland. Chapter 7 explores the tribulations of a Georgia, South Carolina colony under siege, recreating the personal and collective lives, activities, and defensive strategies of this large community retrenched in a fortified camp. The exiles of the Great Dismal Swamp are the subject of Chapter 8. The area between Virginia and North Carolina is believed to have held the largest number of maroons in the country. From the borderlands to the hinterland, they pursued contrasting social and economic strategies, from living in isolation to working for enslaved men. Maroons have sometimes been portrayed as bandits by their contemporaries and by modern historians. But as Chapter 9 shows, bandits were rather a maroon subgroup. The most ubiquitous types of banditry and the personalities and activities of a number of bandits are examined in order to assess their impact on the enslaved community and society at large. Chapter 10 focuses on the role maroons played or are supposed to have played in slave conspiracies and insurrections in the Carolinas and Virginia. Maroonage only vanished with the demise of slavery, but as the last chapter shows, death, raids, sickness, and imprudence were the immediate causes that ended most maroons' lives in the woods and swamps. Yet, despite all odds, in generation after generation, with apprehension doubtless and self-confidence unquestionably, countless men and women, determined to carve out of the wilderness a better life for themselves and their children, continue to embark on hopeful freedom quests. 1. The development of maroonage in the South. Maroons made their entry early in the annals of Southern history. They appeared in all colonies where slavery was introduced, and the struggle against them has been particularly well chronicled. Evidence of their activities can be found in treaties with Indian nations, official correspondence, petitions, and in innumerable statutes and acts. Laws, of course, are not to be taken at face value. They are not an indication of what really transpires in any given society. Some anticipate potential situations, while others are in response to actual events. The thousands of slave statutes enacted, revised, annulled, and extended from the early 1600s to the 1860s are only one indicator of a large reality that was also made up of customs, slaveholders' private practices, ignorance, lax enforcement, and enforcement even after the acts had been repealed, interpretation, accommodation, municipal regulations, and other idiosyncrasies. While the statutes examined here do not cover the entire spectrum of maroon activities and anti-maroon legislation, implicitly and with the above caveats, they and other documents help uncover what maroonage was like in the early days and how it grew. From a longer time perspective, the development of anti-maroon measures maps the geographic locations of the maroons, the evolving, real, potential, rumored, and fabricated threat they posed, and, concurrently, white anxiety. The Upper South. There is little doubt that many Africans ran away to the woods as soon as they arrived in the colonies, but perhaps the earliest reference to their escapes in Virginia dates back to 1640. On June 30th, the General Court granted a commission to two men, to raise a party in what became York County, to go in pursuit of certain runaway Negroes and to bring them to the governor. A month later, John Punch, an African indentured servant, and two of his European colleagues were brought back from Maryland, where they had run off. They were all condemned to receive 30 lashes, but whereas the Scot and the Dutchman had to serve 4 additional years, the court stressed that, the third being a Negro, he had to become a slave for life. This ruling is considered the first legal evidence of the gradual establishment of slavery in Virginia, where most blacks at the time were still indentured servants. In January 1639, however, a distinction had already been made between all whites, indentured and free, and all blacks, with the following statute: all persons except Negroes to be provided with arms and ammunition, or be fined at the pleasure of the governor and council. By 1660, the enslaved status of blacks was firmly in place, and a new act passed in March 1661 to discourage interracial escapes stressed that if an English servant ran away with Negroes, since time could not be added to servitude, the servant had to work for the black runaway's owner for as long as the latter was absent. As noted in the introduction, British settlers never referred to maroons in the American mainland as maroons, but instead as runaways or outliers, and in the statutes, the difference between both groups has to be inferred from the context. One case in point is the September 1672 Act entitled An Act for the Apprehension and Suppression of Runaways, Negroes, and Slaves. It made reference to many Negroes who have lately been and now are out in rebellion in sundry parts of this country. They had not been found, and it was feared that other Negroes, Indians, or servants might decide to join them, which might result in many mischiefs and have very dangerous consequences. These feared runaways could not be short-term truants, nor could they be escapees hidden in towns. They had to be groups of people who settled independently and could attract a following of exploited people and provide them with a refuge. Through raids for food and ammunition and direct harassment, they could represent a threat to the development of the colony. To guard against that potential peril, it was enacted that any such Negro, mulatto, Indian slave, or servant for life who would join the many Negroes could be wounded or killed on the spot if he resisted. If some runaways had settled on their own, others had found their way to the Indian nations. Therefore, the act also required Native Americans to apprehend those who would come to them and to bring them to a justice of the peace. For their services, they were to receive 20 arms' length of Roanoke, or the value thereof in goods. This co-optation of Native Americans was one of the cornerstones of the early struggle against maroons. On June 8, 1680, the colony added an Act for Preventing Negroes' Insurrections to its corpus of laws. While the first part addressed the rebellious behavior of slaves, the second dealt directly with any Negro or other slave who shall absent himself from his master's service and lie hid and lurking in obscure places, committing injuries to the inhabitants. In a reaffirmation of the 1672 law, they could lawfully be killed if they resisted arrest. The phraseology, obscure places, to which is often added swamps and woods, came up again and again in legal documents throughout the South, including in the 19th century. It was meant to cover and at the same time define the maroon landscape, the obscure places close to farms and plantations, and the hinterland of marshland and forests. The earliest act to deal nominally with maroons, an act for suppressing outlying slaves, appeared on the books on April 16, 1691. Justices of the peace were asked to issue warrants against them and sheriffs to raise adequate forces to capture them. The act gave one detail about their activities. They hid and lurked in obscure places, killing hogs and committing other injuries. Killing hogs, as well as cows, sheep, and poultry, was a typical maroon occupation for survival, which continued to be a major point of contention until the end of Marronage. A few months after the act was passed, two maroons went on trial. Mingo, also spelled Mingo, a mulatto slave, Lawrence, and the English servant Richard Wilkins were, a considerable time, run away and laid out. Mingo and Lawrence had escaped from Rosegill, the large estate of Ralph Warmley, who held in servitude close to 20% of the county's black men, women, and children. The three caused great disturbance and terror. Like a number of maroons, they were on the move and were disturbing the good subjects of Virginia close and far. Between the 150 miles that separated Middlesex and Rappahannock, where they were active, lay four counties. Lawrence was accused of kicking open the door of James Douglas's room at Warmley's Hog House and grabbing two shirts, a pair of breeches, and a gun still in his possession when he was arrested. In Rappahannock, Mingo raided the overseer John Powell's quarters, taking two guns, a carbine, and other items. Mingo, Lawrence, and Wilkins, well-armed, killed hogs and other livestock that belonged to a variety of people in Rappahannock County. But on or just before October 26th, Mingo surrendered to John Powell. The circumstances are not documented, but if he had resisted or fled, he could legitimately have been killed. Thus, by giving himself up, Mingo was saving his life. He was brought to the court in Middlesex and confessed to stealing the firearms. Because no offense could be proved to have been committed in that county, he was transported to Rappahannock, where he was sentenced to receive 30 lashes and to be whipped in the same manner by one constable after another until he reached his owner's estate. Lawrence was captured, too. Tried on December 7th in Middlesex, he confessed to the theft of Douglas's gun. No documentation about his fate has surfaced. Severe whippings were the mildest punishments maroons received. Over the years, more brutal rules were enacted. In August 1701, Billy became the first notorious maroon whose personal depredations were denounced in a piece of legislation when Virginia passed an act for the more effectual apprehending of an outlying Negro who hath committed diverse robberies and offenses. Billy had already had three owners, and by then he had been living in the woods for several years. He was known to be lying out and lurking in obscure places supposed within the countries of James City, York, and New Kent. He was devouring and destroying the stocks and crops, robbing the houses of and committing and threatening other injuries to several of His Majesty's good and liege people within this, his colony, and dominion of Virginia. Mindful of the potential help he could receive, the act stressed that anyone who wittingly and willingly entertain, assist, harbor, conceal, truck, or trade with this said Negro Billy would be committing a felony and be punished accordingly. A reflection of the extent of his depredations and the increasing severity of anti-maroon measures, Billy was condemned to death in absentia. In his actions, one can see the characteristics that marked generations of maroons after him. Like some isolated individuals and small groups, Billy was itinerant. He roamed along an arc of 50 miles. As practically all maroons did, he appropriated stock and crops and traded with and received assistance from enslaved men and women. And like the bandits, he burglarized houses and threatened his victims. By the beginning of the 18th century, there were enough new Negroes, that is, recently arrived Africans who ran away and, by default, could only find refuge in the woods that the Virginia legislature felt compelled to add a statute in October 1705 that addressed their particular circumstances. It concerned runaways who did not speak English and cannot, or through obstinacy, will not declare the name of his or her master or owner. The offenders were to be kept in the public gaol until claimed by their rightful owner or hirer. The article was one of 41 of an act concerning servants and slaves, passed within a comprehensive law that addressed many other issues. It strongly reinforced the arsenal of brutal anti-maroon regulations. In Article 37, the act introduced the concept of outlawry against men and women who hid in the swamps, woods, and other obscure places, killed hogs, and committed other injuries. A quorum of two justices of the peace was required to issue a proclamation ordering them to surrender. The statement had to be placed on a Sunday at the door of every church and chapel, immediately following service. If maroons still refused to come out after being thus exhorted through written words posted in the middle of sacred white territory, they could be lawfully killed, their owner being reimbursed their assessed value on public funds. The sentence reserved to the men and women who did not resist arrest had to be severe enough for the reclaiming any such incorrigible slave and terrifying others from the like practices. They could be punished either by dismembering or any other way not touching their lives, which included the cutting off of toes, ears, and penises. Castration remained legal until 1769. In early March 1710, Maroonage came to the forefront once again, this time linked to a conspiracy. It was exposed by Will, who revealed that a dangerous plot had been hatched in James City by great numbers of the said Negroes and Indian slaves for making their escape by force from the services of their masters and for destroying and cutting off such of Her Majesty's subjects as should oppose their design. Several men were questioned about the conspiracy, which counted Africans, native-born men, and at least one Native American. On March 24th, it was determined that Scipio, Jackman, Salvador, a Native American, Tom, and Sean were the principal contrivers. Their behavior had been recently very rude and insolent. Peter, also a principal leader, had escaped and was lurking in or about the said county or the counties of James City, Prince George, or Isle of Wight. In the end, Scipio and Salvador were condemned to a gruesome death. They were to be hanged, decapitated, and quartered. As a deterrent to potential conspirators, each man's head and body parts were to be displayed in different counties. By the first decade of the 18th century, then, increasingly barbaric sentences had reflected the colonists' growing fear. While the informer, Will's, identity was held secret, it was discovered, and so intense was the resentment that several Negroes laid wait for his life. He was therefore sent away to the Northern Neck. To encourage others to betray conspiracies, he received his freedom in October 1710 in exchange for £40 to his owner. What makes this episode particularly noteworthy is that it was a premeditated mass desertion of armed men intent on settling outside white-controlled territory. It seems to be the first and, so far, the only recorded case of a large-scale simultaneous movement of people whose objective was to reach some secluded area to form a maroon community. In contrast, throughout American maroon history, with few, limited exceptions, people escaped individually or in small groups before regrouping. In April 1733, for example, six men ran away from two Middlesex estates, banded together in the swamps, and broke into a store in Gloucester County, stealing goods valued at £30. As a posse pursued them, they successfully defended themselves with firearms and other weapons. The potential peril that armed raiders could present was taken so seriously that the sheriffs of Gloucester, Middlesex, King and Queen, Richmond, Lancaster, and Essex counties were given orders to raise forces to search their respective areas. If they discovered that the band had moved to another location, they had to inform the sheriff of that county to start his own hunt for the runaways and felons, who were to be caught dead or alive. The search was to focus most particularly on Dragon Swamp, located in Middlesex County. Possible dismembering, outlawry, and accrued vigilance did little to prevent or even reduce Marronage. On August 10, 1721, Governor Alexander Spotswood informed the Executive Council that diverse Negroes, as well as his own, who lived on the frontier of Rappahannock County, ran away and were believed to be gone to the Blue Ridge Mountains of Western Virginia. He feared that it would be difficult to apprehend them, and should their number increase, it would prove detrimental to the frontier settlers and of ill consequence to the peace of the colony as a whole. By then, the representation of enslaved men and women in the total population had increased to 30%. As Virginia developed its tobacco production, Africans were brought in ever larger numbers. Between 1710 and 1720, 7,200 had disembarked from 51 ships. From a high of 52% in 1710, they still represented 45% of the enslaved population. Newcomers were the most likely to escape and settle into the wilderness, and with more Africans entering the Upper South, colonists were increasingly worried about having to share space with maroon communities, in addition to Native Americans. Virginians were also well aware that maroon colonies were entrenched in the mountains of Jamaica. Hoping to avoid a similar situation, they sought the assistance of the Indian nations. On September 11, 1722, Governor Spotswood told the chiefs of the Five Nations, "You sent me last year a belt of wampum as a testimony to your promise that you would seize and carry to Virginia some runaway Negroes belonging to that colony, whenever you did discover and meet with them in the woods. Now, I make a general proposition to you on account of runaways and slaves belonging to Virginia, viz., that if any such Negro or slave shall hereafter fall into your hands, you shall straightway conduct them to Colonel George Mason's house on Potomac River, and I do, in behalf of that colony, engage that you shall there receive immediately upon the delivery of every such runaway one good gun and two blankets, or the value thereof. And in token of this proposition and engagement, I lay down 5 guns and 500 flints. The chiefs, however, were not overly enthusiastic about helping. Acknowledging their previous failure at rounding up Virginia's maroons, they replied to Spotswood's plea for collaboration. "As to the proposition you made relating to Negroes, we promise that if any runaway Negroes or slaves shall happen to fall into our hands, we will carry them to Colonel Mason's on Potomac River for ye reward you proposed. But as to those Negroes which you said we promised last year to send home, we hope you will excuse us because they lie very much out of our way and may be had more easily by other Indians. Yet, if we can serve Virginia in any other thing, we shall be glad of an opportunity of doing it." Native Americans' cooperation was also sought in Maryland. The council accused the Shawnees in 1722 of entertaining our runaway Negro slaves at their towns upon Potomac River. To entice them to give the maroons up, the council proposed to offer 2 leaders, a Stroud match coat, and a pair of silk stockings as a preliminary gesture of friendship, and any Shawnee would receive 2 coats and 1 gun for every runaway he would return. In 1725, the General Assembly passed an act to encourage the takers up of runaway slaves that shall be taken up by any person and brought in from the backwoods. which established a reward of £5 to anyone who would bring maroons from the hinterland northwest of the Monocacy River. Mountains around the river reached almost 2,000 feet and were as good refuge as any. The act also specified that the runaways would have one ear cut off for the first offense, the other for the second offense, in addition to the letter R branded on the chin. A year later, on July 19, 1726, the upper house of the assembly, deploring that sundry Negroes made their escape to the Shawano Shawnee town, to the great prejudice of the proprietors, recommended further actions to prevent their escape. It also proposed to increase the attractiveness of the incentives to capture or turn them in. The new measures did not discourage some maroons. On March 25, 1729, Eleanor Kasheka, 22, recounted a conversation she had heard around the previous Christmas. A number of enslaved men and women from various places met in the kitchen and quarters of Captain Richard Smith and discussed the recent visit of the African Harry, John Miller, absent a considerable time, who came back to see his shipmates. He reportedly said that there were many Negroes among the Indians in the Monocacy Mountains. In Virginia, the threat posed by maroons settling in the Blue Ridge Mountains formed a central part of a geopolitical strategy envisioned by William Byrd II, author, planter, and founder of Richmond. He advocated the exploration of this important barrier, the mountain range, because it might be rich in minerals, and proposed the erection of fortifications in the most vulnerable passes to safeguard against French encroachment and to prevent the Negroes taking refuge there, as they do in the mountains of Jamaica, to the great annoyance of the king's subjects, and these will be the more dangerous, because the French will always be ready to supply them with arms and to make use of them against us in all occasions. To impede this political alliance of maroons and foreign expansionist powers, he promoted the immigration of Protestants, a proposal he made to the Swiss-born, London-based Quaker Johann Rudolph Ox, whose settlements he believed would hamper any attempt by maroons to establish their own. Still agitating the specter of Jamaica, where the first Maroon War was going on, Byrd, in a letter dated July 12, 1736, to John Percival, Earl of Egmont, the first president of the Georgia Board of Trustees, recommended putting an end to the introduction of slaves into Virginia, which he feared could one day be known as New Guinea and the rest of the colonies, lest they prove as troublesome and dangerous everywhere as they have been lately in Jamaica, where, besides a vast expense of money, they have cost the lives of many of His Majesty's subjects. We have mountains in Virginia, too, to which they may retire as safely and do as much mischief as they do in Jamaica. To Virginia's south, North Carolina was grappling its own maroons and those who came down from the north. An early mention of this particular problem appears in the records in 1698, when four sturdy runaway slaves, who arrived from Virginia in a shallop, a small boat, were accused of having killed three hogs belonging to Roger Snell. The men were armed and resisted when Snell and two others confronted them. In the end, the maroons were subdued and taken 70 miles away to be kept in custody. As had been the case further north, Native Americans' assistance was eagerly sought in controlling the maroons. John Brickell, in his 1737 Natural History of North Carolina, noted that Indians were very expeditious in finding out the Negroes that frequently run away from their masters into the woods, where they commit many outrages against the Christians, as it happened in Virginia not long since, where above 300 joined together and did a great deal of mischief before they were suppressed. He added that Indians generally found the maroons' haunts in much less time than it took white men, 24 maroons were hung, he asserted, after Indians tracked them in the woods where they had found refuge following a failed conspiracy. Brickell was quick to claim that blacks preferred to be captured by Christians because they were terrified of Native Americans who, according to him, tortured them with delight. In 1715, an act concerning servants and slaves was passed. At a time when whites in North Carolina numbered 7,500 and blacks 3,700, the statutes concerning runaways were mostly instructions to owners and overseers about the punishments to be administered to escapees and the penalties colonists would incur if they harbored them. In 1741, a more comprehensive code was enacted, amended three times. It remained firmly in place throughout the colonial era. It, too, referred to maroons by using the expedient phraseology, and whereas many times slaves run away and lie out hid and lurking in the swamps, woods, and other obscure places, killing cattle and hogs, and committing other injuries to the inhabitants in this government. And in this colony, too, maroons who did not return after a proclamation had been issued against them, were outlawed, and could legitimately be killed. Since owners were to be compensated on public funds, they had little incentive to preserve the maroons' lives. When Abraham was outlawed in 1774, for example, the person who would bring him back alive was to receive only 40 shillings, but he would get £5 for his head. In sum, maroons continued to be a vexing problem to North Carolinians for decades. As was the case elsewhere, armed groups who raided plantations and farms aroused fears of insurrections throughout the 18th and 19th centuries. The Lower South. South Carolina passed its first Act to Prevent Runaways on November 7, 1683, and on February 7, 1691, the legislature adopted an Act for the Better Ordering of Slaves, modeled on Barbadian laws, Barbados being the place of origin of half the colonists. By then, the colony counted about 2,500 whites and 1,100 blacks. Article 9 of the Act mentioned that a sheriff, having cognizance of the haunt, residence, or hiding place of any runaway slave, had to raise a convenient party of men, not exceeding 20, and with them to pursue, apprehend, and take the said runaways, either alive or dead. More generally, if runaways suffered in life or limb, no one was liable under the law. Other texts followed in 1693 and 1695, and in 1696, another Act for the Better Ordering of Slaves was adopted to prevent the mischiefs which, as the number of slaves shall increase, too much liberty may occasion. Instead of focusing on rewards and fines to whites, it itemized the penalties runaways would incur. Escaping with intent to leave the colony was punishable by death, as was running away for the fifth time, although the death penalty could be substituted by the cutting off of the Achilles tendon. Males were to receive 40 lashes and face branding for the first offense and be castrated if they were over 16 and repeat offenders. Females were to be whipped, branded, and have their ears cut off. Responding to a specific maroon threat a few years later, at a time when blacks exceeded the white population for the third consecutive year, on June 20, 1711, the Commons House of Assembly passed a resolution asking the governor to take the necessary measures to suppress armed runaways who robbed and plundered houses and plantations and spread great fear and terror among the white population. One man, whose name was Sebastian, stood out among the people who caused barbarities, felonies, and abuses. He was described as a Spanish Negro, indicating perhaps that he had come from Florida. He was accused, among other depredations, of burning down a widow's house. In October, the governor offered a bounty of £15 to whoever would take him dead or alive. As was the case in the Upper South, too, Native Americans were requested to contribute to the anti-Maroon fight. The House asked the governor to employ a number of Indians to assist the men sent to apprehend, hunt, and take the runaway Negroes. Sebastian was surrounded by Native Americans, killed one of them, but was captured and later executed. In May 1735, South Carolina's militia was ordered to apprehend several white persons and blacks living in the swamp at the head of the Wando River. They were accused of outrages and robberies. The order did not specify the location or the size of the groups. The disturbances continued, and a great consternation descended in December when it was feared that the Negroes were going to rise. A large number, believed to be 100, gathered in the woods, possibly to plan an uprising, perhaps also to establish a settlement there. What was of particular concern was the fact that they were armed and had ammunition. Some were captured along with their weapons, as well as 2 barrels of powder, 2 barrels of shot, and 1 barrel of flint. Following the 1739 Stono Uprising, during which Africans were trying to reach St. Augustine, killed 21 whites, a new comprehensive code was passed in 1740. Among other things, it listed the generous rewards whites and free Indians, but not free and enslaved blacks, could receive if they caught a runaway who had been absent 6 months on the south side of the Savannah River. They would get £50 for a man, 25 for women and boys over 12, and £5 for children, provided they were alive. A man's scalp, with the 2 ears, would bring £20. The reward doubled for a man or his scalp when brought from the south side of the St. John's River. At the time, and for many years thereafter, the complicated geopolitics of the region was one of South Carolinians' main preoccupations, with black people at its center. The danger that the enslaved population represented to the survival of the colony was deemed greater than any other threat. The same year as the Stono Uprising, Britain started a war with Spain and, as a retaliatory measure, wanted to ban all exports of rice to France and Spain. South Carolinian merchants petitioned the British House of Commons, asking for an exception because, at this present precarious time, this ban may render the whole colony an easy prey to their neighboring enemies, the Indians and Spaniards, and also to those yet more dangerous enemies, their own Negroes, who are ready to revolt on the first opportunity and are 8 times as many in number as there are white men able to bear arms. And the danger in this respect is greater since the unhappy expedition to St. Augustine. The petitioner's figures were correct. The colony counted 25,000 whites and 40,000 blacks, and blacks could and did rebel, flee to St. Augustine, find refuge among Indian nations, and form autonomous Maroon communities that raided plantations and made new recruits. They could inflict heavy damage and aggravate the colony's precarious position in early America. South Carolina's fears were thus well-founded. In 1751, a new act concerned slaves which run away and lie out for a considerable space of time, at length become desperate, and stand upon their defense with knives, weapons, or arms. If whites were to arrest any such runaway of at least 6 months who defended himself with a knife, sword, cutlass, gun, pistol, or other weapon, they would collect a reward. And if wounded or disabled, they would get an additional £20 from the owner. If the catcher was enslaved, he was entitled to only half. The act is noble in that, contrary to the 1740 iteration, it tried to entice free and enslaved blacks to hunt down the Maroons. In addition, it enumerates the various types of weapons Maroons were known to possess. But even more important, it clearly, if inadvertently, stated that they use them to defend themselves. There is nothing in the act about outliers attacking colonists at gunpoint or cutlass in hand as during the Stono Uprising. All the Maroons did with their arsenal, the act acknowledged, was to stand up in self-defense. However, this act of self-protection was considered illegitimate as the individuals, by running away, had placed themselves outside the law. Like other colonies, South Carolina employed Native Americans in the fight against the Maroons. Its strategy was twofold. Remote nations were asked to deny sanctuary to absconders and to turn them in when they caught them, and those closest to white areas were used as trackers and hunters of the Maroons who had settled autonomously. In December 1736, for example, the Upper and Lower Creeks agreed to bring any runaway who came to them to the garrisons of Savannah or Palachicola. They would receive 4 blankets or 2 guns, or the value in other goods for each live returnee on the further side of the Oconee River, 1 gun elsewhere, and 1 blanket for a head. A similar treaty was signed by Georgia. It is important to emphasize that the colonists wanted not only to prevent the loss of property, but more importantly, the alliance of Native Americans and African Americans against the white population. As the settlers discovered, the former were not monolithic. They formed alliances with and fought against other Indian nations, colonists of various European stripes, and enslaved and runaway blacks, depending on a variety of factors, including the changing politics of the time. In May 1751, for example, a half-breed man from the Cherokee Nation enticed 6 enslaved men to run away to Cherokee land, promising to take them from there to a place where they could depend on their freedom. 3 came back, but the others told the Cherokees the white people was coming up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.